Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another webinar at the National Library of Scotland. My name is Kenny Redpath, and I'm the Events Officer at the Library. Today, I'm delighted to be introducing Lesley Riddoch, who is here to talk about her new book, Huts, A Place Beyond. Lesley, as I'm sure many of you are aware, is an award-winning broadcaster, journalist, author, land reform campaigner, and lover of all things Nordic. She writes weekly columns for a number of national newspapers and is a contributor to BBC Question Time, Scotland Tonight, and Any Questions. She is founder and director of Nordic Horizons, a policy group that brings Nordic experts to the Scottish Parliament. She has won two Summy Awards for her Daily Radio Scotland show and edited The Scotswoman, a 1995 edition of The Scotsman, written by its female staff. I could not believe that that was 25 years ago. In October this year, she was awarded a 2020 Fletcher of Saltoun Award for her contribution to public life. I am delighted to hand over to you, Lesley.
Thanks very much, Kenny. Can I just make sure, can I know if everyone can hear me all right? Can you hear me, Kenny?
Everything's going well.
Right, okay. It's always just as well to check out before you kind of hammer on. Well, hello, kind of however many people there are there that I can't see. I'm hoping that you are there and you're up for a talk about what we basically do with our spare time. I mean, that's what the book that I've just written, there's the image of it, Huts, A Place Beyond. That's what it's really about. I mean, depending on your own background and associations, huts will just be, for a lot of people, it's just like sheds. It's shabby. It's makeshift. It's kind of, you know, it's just rubbish, basically. And there's the rub, because we seem to be practically the only people that have a sort of difficulty with things that are passed down from generations, made with tender, loving care by identifiable grandparents, low impact in terms of sustainability, but totally loved. Many people will sort of have a wee association with the Bruins. The Bruins had a button Ben, which was absolutely the archetypal way that huts work for people. The whole shebang, the whole chaotic Bruin family kind of went there. It was absolutely a kind of home from home for them. And that kind of idea very probably came from one of the hutting communities that sadly exists no more in Scotland. But anyway, this whole thing started from me a way back. Let's see if I can get this. There we are. PowerPoint to work. This is just pictures, by the way, because they do seem to me to speak 1,000 words. But anyway, a very long time ago in the 1990s, I was billeted up in Aberdeenshire for 3 months. Just the Aberdeenshire reporter came down to Glasgow. It was just a shift around. And I had the option of living in Aberdeen in a hotel room for 3 months, which seemed a bit, sorry, Aberdeen, but just a bit kind of not really that appealing. Or finding somewhere that I could rent for 3 months. And the only place you could rent that had a phone, remember this is 1985 or something, between Inverness and Aberdeen, was at the bottom of this hill that you're seeing here. It was a house that had a phone. It could be rented. I rented it and duly went in and out to Aberdeen to do my reporter's work. And I loved that, Glenn. I often would see this isolated looking hut at the top of the hill and kind of was mystified a wee bit, you know, always meant to go up and have a look, but the 3 months just went by. So it was Hug Monet when I was back with my boyfriend. We went stotting up on actual Hug Monet. It looked abandoned, the house, but I just sort of knocked on the door anyway. And a guy came to the door. I mean, I can't remember which of us got a bigger fright. It turned out, of course, that he was a professor of anthropology, as you do, from Edinburgh University, Alan Campbell. And he remembered that quite obvious snoop around on my part. I mean, we came out with a half bottle of whiskey pretty quickly, and I think managed to cover our tracks. But a couple of years later, he decided to stop renting it. He remembered that I was obviously interested, phoned me at Radio Scotland and said, look, this place will die if somebody a bit mad like you doesn't come and take this on. So I thought, well, why not? So for 7 very eccentric years, I rented this bothy. I mean, it's a house, it's not a hut, and it was never originally a bothy. It's been inhabited by many families, but it's 1200 foot up the side of the hill. It has no path to it. It has no running water, no electricity. And so kind of these days, that makes it somewhere that doesn't really attract many people for full-time living. Now, this, I hasten to add, is 15 years after I stopped renting it. Otherwise, that guttering would never have been in that state. But it was all pretty basic. But I absolutely loved it. I would have to say, anybody who came with me was usually fairly aghast at the lack of toilet facilities and such like. But to me, it was just a huge, huge wheeze, basically, and a really brilliant way of relaxing. that's looking above it across to the hills. You can see in a clear day to Mount Keen, actually, as one of the Monroes. And having climbed Mount Keen, I could actually identify the field that my bothy was in, because it was full of tansies, which stood out yellow in the landscape, even from the distance of Mount Keen. So I kind of understood in Scottish terms that I was pretty weird. I met maybe 2 other people who had this sort of arrangement, but nobody else. And then fate took me to Hammerfest, which is the world's northernmost town, right at the top of Finnmark, right at the top of Norway. I met Inger-Lisa Matheson here, who's become a lifelong friend, and discovered something about huts. This is Inger-Lisa. This is her mother, grandmother-in-law, Björg. This is her grandfather-in-law, Ola. Björg is a teacher. Ola is a fisherman. And the family between them have 7 houses. That's, you know, I could go through them all, but if you do feel like getting the book, you'll get the full explanation. They're family houses that are shared with siblings. They're huts that can be used at the weekend. There's even a hut in Croatia because one of their sons married a lassie from Pula. And, you know, they are not the king and queen. They are normal citizens in Finnmark. And that really started me thinking, because, you know, even if you get this idea that huts are for places for people to get away from it all, well, these people already are away from it all. You know, they are the world's northernmost town. So it began to get me thinking a lot about what's sort of normal everywhere else apart from Scotland. This is what's normal. This is this wee one is Aurora, which is Inger-Lisa's baby daughter. And that's Marianne, her mother-in-law. And this is pretty typical. That's the kind of family huts hütte behind them, 2 of them. And that's a pretty normal scene. There's some reindeer skin down. They've made a huge armchair out of the snow. The snowmobiles are sitting at the back to kind of scoot around and meet people. There's plenty of logs. They've been got in, you know, long ago, and everybody's, you know, there's indoor chairs outdoor because actually it's very dry, the kind of snow they get. So you're not really damaging anything very much. And weirdly, even in about minus 10, it doesn't feel that cold, which is bizarre. But then that's because they're wearing the right gear as well, because they go a lot. They go every weekend in the winter, and particularly in the winter, because when it snows and freezes, it's far easier to get about because the fjords freeze, the wee lochs freeze, the land, which can be boggy in the summer because permafrost thaws and melts and becomes very sort of gluey, it's hard. So actually it's easier to get around in the winter. And people have a whale of a time. They're all here every weekend. What are they doing? Work. One of the things that you notice when you have a hut, it's a lot of fun, but it's also it is constant work, especially if you've got a wooden hut. This is Inger-Lisa and Ola. just having to get rid of massive lumps of snow off the roof, because otherwise the weight would eventually crush the roof. So that's just quite matter-of-factly done every now and again. And nobody's kind of a shrinking violet, or there's not very much health and safety going on. People are, however, extremely safety conscious because they do stuff so much. They carry it in their own heads, where they can go and what the limits should be. But this is a paper that I read, which by two ethnologists in Norway, that again got me really thinking. This idea that leisure is the opposite of wage labor, not the opposite of work. So there's plenty of work involved, but it's great fun. It's fun for people to do things together. And what I found, having a bothy for 7 years myself, is that as a woman who's often been surrounded by very capable men in terms of power tools and all sorts of, you know, repairs, I got to try myself. I got to have a go. I got to make mistakes. I got to make dreadful mistakes and learn and feel hands-on and responsible. And that's what I notice around huts. Children are able to join in doing stuff too. Anyway, that's us off for a big visiting session, which it seems to be what the huts are for. And ironically, the people that you meet when you're going around on the snowmobiles and Skidy are basically your neighbours from Hammerfest, who you could have met during the week, but you don't, because the weekends are for this, and that's what everybody does. So this is Skidy. In Sami, it means that's the reindeer herding peoples of the high north. It means where rivers meet. So that's what Inger-Lisa thinks is a forest. I kind of have difficulty with that myself, but that's the sort of tundra scrub that you get that far north. And all the huts are tucked up inside that forest. It's got a heck of a lot of cabins, one for every seven people. I mean, that's pretty much one for every extended family. So you just don't come across people who don't either have directly a cabin themselves, or have a bidey in, or a half sister, brother, friend that has a cabin. So you spend every weekend there. And this is pretty normal at that kind of wooded latitude that we belong to as well. We're in the same latitude as Denmark, the south of Sweden, and of Finland. There's the kind of frequency that hut ownership sits at. And there's dear old Scotland. So this is the weird thing. We just do not have, in any number really at all, we do not have wooden huts. Now, why the difference? Really, it does, so it is a bit, how long have you got? The easy answer is land ownership, that essentially land has been so hard to get hold of here and so expensive that if you did get hold of a bit of land, you certainly wouldn't be putting a humble hut on it. So that's the hugest obstacle. All huts tend to be sitting in forests and woodland here at our latitude, and in the southern hemisphere, the batches of New Zealand are the same. And so the way that forestry has been owned has a big part to play. It has exactly the same sort of concentrations as land ownership itself. In fact, there are even fewer people who own forestry in Scotland. Forestry Commission Scotland has tended to be a bit of a closed entity. It's not designed for people to stay in. It's just designed for day trips. And of course, where we are now is that you actually get concessions on death duties by buying woodland. So if there's little bits of woodland for sale, and you've likely seen them, of course you'd think people could club together, buy it and have little huts there. Nah. You're not going to get there faster, and you won't be able to outbid wealthy people who can use this as a means of avoiding death duties. So the way forests are is pretty important for us. The rest of it, it could take some time to talk through, but fundamentally, Norway became a very consensual society. And because everybody wanted access to nature, and because part of their nation building project after independence in 1905, was to shape up an idea of Norway that was distinct from Sweden, distinct from Denmark, their previous colonial rulers. they went, in a sense, back to basics, back to the bonder, the peasants is the English word for it. It just doesn't conjure up what it means in Norwegian. The independent small farmer, the building block of Norwegian society, the hardy guys who live up the fjords, the descendants of the Vikings. So these guys and this sort of mythology has grown up very much that Norway is a place of nature. And you can't really be a proper Norwegian without being able to have access to it. And the more that that came to the fore during the independence period and afterwards, the more it became impossible to only have those goodies handed out to middle-class people. Aberdeen needed to have a shot at having their own huts. And of course, Aberdeen could, because tens of thousands of people own the land in Norway, so you're not up against brick walls, bureaucrats, or lairds. So all of this has kind of rather helped. And of course, the Norwegians had the earliest guaranteed holidays with pay in 1919. It took until the Working Time Directive was passed by the European Union, ironically enough, for Britain to get there almost a century later with mandatory pay. Up till then, it's always been optional. So this is kind of all the reasons that our style has been cramped so badly in terms of what we get up to at weekends and how we can have little escapes. This all took me to another part of Norway, right at the other end, just beside Oslo, in Oslo Fjord. There are a clump of little islands which became hutting islands in 1922. And that date rang a bell for me because 1922 is when Carbeth began. So is that not extraordinary? Here they are, 1,000 miles apart, these two hutting communities, which were both full of working class people from the east end of Oslo and, in Carbeth's example, from Glasgow and from Clydebank. And they both still exist. That they do is a bit of a miracle. This is Linnøya, which is a just beautiful place to walk around. You're tripping on Norwegian flags. People are very proud of what they still regard as their newly acquired freedom. It's 100 years old now. Pretty much every other person's got a boat as well as a hut. There's swimming events. In the winter, these huts actually are out of use because there's an agreement that they're only used from May till October. Once it gets very cold, there's a danger that the water pipes, if they're not drained, will crack. So people tend to be able to walk away from them and just not go back until the next summer begins. And just so you get an idea, that's how close to Oslo that Linnøya is. That's a 10-minute ferry journey to some of the most expensive real estate in Europe. And yet these low key wooden huts that are the descendant huts from the first set of folk who were given the plots in 1922, they're still sitting there and nobody has chipped them out. That would never happen in Scotland. When something's valuable, when land's wanted, when a war's over, allotments just got shut down, people got kicked off. And that's always been the pattern here. You just have a temporary toehold on land. You don't have it like this. So here's just looking back in history. This is part of Linnøya back in, that must have been before 1922 because it's mostly tents. And this is how they basically went about it. The folk who were over camping and they had to row over from Oslo. So that was, you know, not a small thing. They were the ones who were given hut sites. And it was a way to get over dirty camping, to just have a modern note, because there were the same problems. There was nowhere, no toilet facilities on Linnøya. There was actually no public water supply either. So, you know, if you were going to carry something over, the tendency was you'd probably rather carry beer. So it was kind of a bit rock and roll, was Linnøya, albeit that whole families came over. And this rather, this appalled the kind of more respectable citizens who were steaming past Linnøya to their own second homes on the neighbouring peninsula and were seeing all sorts of things coming out of the woods that they just didn't want to see. So there was a huge pressure to do something about Linoia. It had become a scandal by the kind of 1920s period. And surprisingly, what the government decided to do was not what would probably have happened in Scotland, which might well be if you'd blot your copybook, you're out. They decided that the problem wasn't having enough of a stake in the place, having enough facilities, and that the problems of dirty camping would be resolved by hutting. So that's what they did. All these campers got huts, and that's, you'll see there, there's the beginning of that transformation with huts in the background, some camp tents still, but those all got phased out by the 1920s. And this is where we now jump across to Carbeth, because look, there's Carbeth, exactly the same pattern with the tents up at the back of the fellowship camp as was, and the huts there starting beneath them, and exactly the same year. That this happened at all was because of one quite extraordinary fellow called William Ferris. He was a name on a piece of paper, and he would have probably remained that way if I hadn't just been really lucky and managed to find his son, Murray Ferris, 5 days before he was leaving Scotland for good. And William Ferris was an amazing chap. He was born in 1897. He was one of 11 children of born in Govan, to a Govan family, 11 children of whom only two survived past the age of five. So that was your real deal there. The conditions, particularly in Glasgow, but actually in all Scottish cities around that period, were lethal. But he was possibly quite fortunate in that, as far as I can piece together from his son's memories, William Ferris was alive at a time that was a kind of seedbed of socialism, and not just questions of pushing for workers' rights, for any kind of equality, for a proper representation, for all the things that we understand socialism to be pushing for. It was about the whole person as well, and it was about what you did in your leisure time, about getting into nature, very much so because of two organisations that William Ferris seems to have been part of. One was the Socialist Sunday School movement, and pardon me, astonishingly, that has, well, although it was absolutely huge in the west of Scotland, such that Murray remembers hearing Paul Robeson, the black communist singer, I think he would be fine with being described as a communist singer, and he was black, but Paul Robeson was singing, I think in 1960, in Queen's Park in Glasgow. And Murray remembers that the whole of Queen's Park was covered mostly with banners from socialist Sunday schools, which tells you something about how huge that movement was till really quite recently. And yet there's no trace of it that you can find very easily in Scotland at all. What's great about them is it taught, first of all, girls and boys very equal. It had a great emphasis on the outdoors. It taught children Esperanto, because that was going to be the world language of the future. It encouraged them to take minutes, whatever they did. And Murray remembers his dad on perhaps wee expeditions like this with his pals when he was young. He recalls that his dad would, well, he saw that the notes that his dad had made during those childhood forays, and he'd taken minutes even when they went up walks up the back around Govan. So there was a constant emphasis in understanding who you are, respecting your fellow person, people around you, never being talked down to, and having, well, you could say a good conceit of yourself, but the 10 socialist commandments that are actually in the book are really quite uplifting and amazing. The other thing he was involved in was the Clarion movement, which was set up by Robert Blatchford. He set up the paper, the Clarion, and from it came all sorts of spin-offs. One was the Clarion Players, and William Ferris, who had grown up to have a business of a stamp shop in West Nile Street in Glasgow, how he managed to wash the face of himself, his family, on the income of a stamp shop beats me, but he did. He was also the secretary of the Clarion Players, which went on to set up the Citizens Theatre. He was in the Clarion Cyclists. He was a mad keen cyclist, and that became a huge thing. He also set up the first youth hostel in Britain, never mind Scotland, but Britain. He set up the Ramblers Federation, the Caravanning and Camping Club. I mean, there's a list as long as your arm of outdoor organisations that he either set up or was instrumental in setting up, and nobody has a record of him. So this is him in later life. In the interim, he had done some pretty amazing things. I love this one. This is him beside Carbeth Pool, which he also was secretary of. He set up Carbeth Pool beside Carbeth as something for the Carbeth Hutters they could swim in. There was huge swimming galas, and it was a great attraction in the interwar years, attracting about 1,000 people on one occasion. But right back at the beginning is probably the most interesting aspect of how this all happened, because in the 1920s, well, let's take 1918 when this letter was written by William Ferris, who had joined the Highland Cycling Battalion. I didn't even know such a thing existed. But at that point, cycling battalions were doing an awful lot of the signals work and also connecting between the lines in the most horrific places during the war. So he was in the Highland Cycling Battalion. He had, for whatever reason, wound up in Ireland. He was writing to Alan Barnes Graham, who was the owner of Carbeth, asking him if, when he and four or five of his friends, if they survived the war, their hope was, what was keeping them going was that they hoped they could together rent a little hut at Carbeth, because they'd gone there on cycling trips and camping before the war, and they'd saved throughout the war in the War Saving Certificate scheme. And between five or maybe six of them, they had amassed £30. And they hoped that £30 would be enough to put down on a hut to have something to look forward to when they came back. And they were refused. We don't have the letter from Barnes Graham, but the next one, which is sent back to him, is saying, this is William Ferris saying, he wishes that he would be able to speak to the neighbour who warns you about the dangers of having bolshies on your land. Now, remember the times we're talking about, 1918, 1919. This is straight after the Bolshevik Revolution. This is also after the George Square general strike. And it's also after a whole series of tax hikes made by British government to consciously curb land ownership, including death duties being hiked to 40%, which, because of the First World War and many heirs of landed estates dying, meant there could be a double whammy in terms of death duties that forced an extraordinary amount of land to be put up for sale. It's estimated that I think between 1920 and 21, well, I might have got that wrong by a year, something like a fifth to a quarter of Scotland changed hands. There has never been another year like it since then. And many people thought the end of hereditary land ownership was nigh in Scotland. But of course, as we all know, that didn't happen. Marginal estates were sold off. Owners consolidated things by just putting one up for sale. And the bulk of land ownership really continued as normal. But for that small period, there was some bits of land that became available, bought by farmers who were quite keen to diversify and didn't have these very embedded ideas about not letting folk on the land. And some of them were quite happy to think about hutting. So this was what fired Carbeth on. This didn't get chunked down to a farmer. This remained in the family of Alan Barnes Graham. But completely undeterred by all the rejections, William Ferris just went to Carbeth, started camping there, and basically charmed Alan Barnes Graham into changing his mind. And so in 1922, Barnes Graham announced that huts could be built in Carbeth with one condition, which was that William Ferris would take care of the entire thing administratively. He would run it. And so as a result, the only person who never got a hut at Carbeth was William Ferris. But he made it possible for hundreds of other people to this day. There's the swimming galas, and the comparison between, at this point, Norway and Scotland is really striking. On the left there, that's a swimming gala off Linnøya in the 1960s. On the right is all the documentation of the swimming pool, which closed in 1972. So just the same instincts, the same desires, the same abilities to get organized under, at the beginning at least, equally constrained circumstances. Carbeth does live on, but only after an incredible struggle. In 1999, the third generation after that first Barnes Graham inherited the land, wasn't so keen on having the hutters, hiked the rents. There was immediately a rent strike. Many huts mysteriously burned down, and the hutters and the landowner were pretty much at daggers drawn. The hutters made a petition and took it to the Justice Committee of the new Scottish Parliament, asking for help, because if you are a temporary tenant of a hut, you could own the hut, but if you're a temporary tenant of the ground, which you are, because nobody in Scotland, generally speaking, hardly anyone owns the land, you basically have very, very few rights. As successive sets of interwar hutters and their descendants were to find. So realizing that they had no leg to stand on, the Carbeth hutters appealed to the Scottish government, which the Scottish Parliament, which at that time was considering the first Land Reform Act, so it would have slotted in reasonably well. The Scottish Parliament decided to instruct a survey to find out how many other huts there were in Scotland to decide if it was really worth bothering, and discovered that there were only 600, and then decided, you know, don't think we can be bothered. So the Carbeth hutters got no help from them. Happily though, Stirling Council came to the rescue. They did a survey, decided that the huts were each individual conservation areas because of the Arcadia, which is kind of makeshift aesthetic of the huts and the style of them. So ironically, despite the fact that the makeshiftness of the huts has been the reason that they have been gentrified, removed, evicted practically everywhere, it was the only reason they survived in Carbeth. Well, that and a very sympathetic district council. And as soon as the conservation status was there in Carbeth, well, who was ever going to buy the huts? You couldn't destroy them, you couldn't bulldoze them, you couldn't change them. There was a bit of a standoff for a while until eventually the hutters got a loan from Triodos Bank and bought the land. So they'll be paying that off until 2035, and that's what it takes to have a hut in Scotland. Other places, Seaton Sands was one of the biggest hutting communities, probably bigger than Carbeth at one point, down in East Lothian, near Port Seaton. And it started in the same sort of accidental way, actually, when some kids, the Boys Brigade kids that were camping, were shooed off land, saw a chap farming in a field, approached him and asked if they could camp for the summer so their time wasn't wrecked, were able to camp, went back raving about it to their parents. They all came back the next year. And this was an example of a bit of land that had been bought by an unusual eccentric chap who was not a hereditary owner. These were Bruce's camps. I think it was William Bruce. I've suddenly forgotten his Christian name, which is crazy. But he was a lecturer at the East of Scotland Agricultural College. So he was primarily an academic, just keeping his hand in, having bought a bit of land from Lord Elcho, who, if you know your history, would have been horrified to think that anything quite so democratic was happening on land that once belonged to him. And it steadily grew into a hutting site. So there it is, and you can see all these people have, whoops, I don't know if I can go back again. Yeah, people have got all these old railway carriages, just anything makeshift would do. Over time, health and safety came in, the conditions weren't considered to be clean enough, and the decision was made basically that it would be simpler and it would conform more to standards if all of these lovely huts became these. And I'm not passing comment on how people want to spare their spare time, but it just does something to me to see plastic wooden huts, which are caravans basically, all over Scotland. And the other characteristic they have in common with huts everywhere is that the land is not owned by them. This is rented and on the terms of the owner of the site. And that is pretty much as good as it gets for a lot of folk in Scotland. Barry Downs between Carnoustie and Monifieth, again on the East Coast, that was a thriving couple of sites. Barry Downs, Lucknow, Bucky Hillocks, there was quite a number of wee sites. And this is what I think the Bruins Button Ben was based upon. Here are some of the huts at Barry Downs. There was about 65 folk living, well, using them at weekends. Same old story. After four generations, the new owner wasn't interested, raised the rents, quadrupled the water rates, which he wasn't allowed to do, cut off the water, which he wasn't allowed to do, reinstated it. Then, one by one, all the huts were smashed. This is Jim Rowling, who was the last one fighting to keep these huts at Barry Downs. He came from Glasgow. We had a wee house, a wee flat off the Maryhill Road. I met him and his wife Pauline there. And this was their life, absolutely was their life. But they had not a leg to stand on once the tide turned. They came back to discover one weekend that every single window of every hut had been smashed. And despite every attempt by people locally to insist that they did live, they were still living there, they were all evicted in their absence, and Jim died of a massive heart attack a year later. So to me, this is not a zero-sum game. This is heritage that people are being cut off from, and a way to have a better life, which our grandparents and great-grandparents fought for and managed to carve out in this most hostile of environments for any working person to have access to the land. And then over the years, that access has been whittled off and away. And what's been left, their precious little huts, just look so shabby that nobody in a position of power basically gives a damn. And that's the big difference. So here we are today, the Scots, you know, we're either hardy loners, the kind who sit on top of hillsides in kind of electricity-free stone bothies like me. Very hardy loners like Jock Nimlin, one of the mountain men who used to live in caves, sleep in caves when they did their expeditions coming out of Glasgow in the 1940s and 50s. Or indoor families, because, you know, it just gets all too difficult out there to do anything that other than have a daily stroll. And that's just not good enough. We have the most magnificent nature in Europe. That's why it's being bought steadily by people who don't live here, because it is without parallel in the rest of Europe. And yet we are the folk who can hardly appreciate it. And what that means is that in remote areas, second homes are not huts in Scotland. And that means second homes are what should be the first homes of other people, especially in remote areas. You can't, since there's no hutting tradition, if anyone wants a second home, they end up buying somebody else's chance to have an affordable local home in a rural area. That is crippling our rural areas to the degree that some young folk recently had an appeal on social media against the economic clearances that mean they will never get a house on their own in their own homeland. Or it means that our idea of a holiday in Scotland is unaffordably expensive, because we are competing with with foreign visitors on the commercial housing market. No one else at our latitude is. Of course, everyone will have a couple of days off, maybe, or if they can afford it, somewhere kind of posh. But by and large, most folk are taken out of the commercial housing market by huts. They have somewhere to go to that they don't have to plan for, they don't have to book ahead for, they don't have to put a deposit down for, they don't have to check if they'll take dogs. They don't have to worry about any of those things, and they don't have to pay much at all because it's always there and it's heritable. So your children will have that and they'll want it because they'll remember those lovely warm memories of growing up going to the hut too. So that's what we're missing. It's a lot. Thank you for listening.